Now I'd like to welcome on stage Liam Galloway and Timur Yunusov, who are going to present their talk on the ATM hacking.
Thank you. Thank you very much for having us. I realise the subject matter is slightly different from what you're used to, but what we've decided to do is we're going to talk about the process of buying an ATM. Hopefully you can hear me. Shout if you can't hear me. And then we're going to focus more on application control, which is a specific type of software that is installed on many ATMs, which is meant to provide a level of security. And we're going to talk about the reasons why that isn't very secure and some specific case studies for the different applications available, but we won't name the specific applications. You'll see why. Okay. Where is that? The clicker works? Yes. Okay, great. Okay, so just to give you a bit of background on ourselves, so it's a bit of rhyming slang in a way, isn't it? AppSec, WebSec, BankSec, InfoSec. So that broadly talks to some of our background. I spent a lot of time working in payment forensic investigation, so when a merchant gets breached, investigating what happened, trying to help the merchant to remedy the situation and reporting on those events. And we don't have any prior experience with ATM acquisition. I don't think many people do. So the company we work for is called Positive Technologies. And we do services around ATMs, but generally we're reliant on third parties who provide us access to ATMs when we need them, if we need to do something outside of a project. So this was very much a first for us. And hopefully you can all hear me at the back. Is that okay? Nod, yeah, great.
Yeah.
So just to give you a bit of background on this process, so we went about buying an ATM last year, and the idea actually occurred because someone working in our PR team said, hey, I've got this brilliant idea, as they do, and he said, I've read online that security researchers are able to buy ATM parts from eBay and reconstruct a working ATM. Now, some of my colleagues in the company started looking into this process prior to me joining the company, and it looked like actually it was quite challenging. But whilst you can find, if you look on eBay, actually you can find a lot of components relatively easily, but finding enough components and ones which are compatible is quite hard. And it turns out that to get an ATM working, you have to have knowledge of maintenance. And as we experienced ourselves in the company, once you have an ATM, lots of things can go wrong. They're quite sensitive. So I joined the company and decided that basically I would give it a go. So here's another example of an ATM on eBay, and I thought, okay, I'll give this a go. No one's really had that much luck so far. But before we get into that, I'll just give you a bit of a history of ATMs because it's quite interesting. So prior to 1967, so around 1964-65, there was a chap called John Shepherd Barron, and he was an inventor, and he went to his local branch one Saturday and he couldn't take out money because the branch was shut, as many of us are still quite familiar with at a certain time on Saturday. He said, this is ridiculous, there has to be a better way. What can we do about this? So he came up with the initial plan for creating an ATM, and he came to Barclays and he said, I've got an idea, can you help me prototype it? They spent about 2 years working on a prototype for the first ATM. The first ATM was installed by Barclays in 1967, and what it looked like is you were issued with what's essentially a check from, you still have to go to the cashier in your local branch, they would give you what was like a check, you'd put it in, you'd type in a PIN, and it would give you £10 in single £1 notes, which is quite interesting. And then shortly after that, what you see is a lot of individual banks with companies start creating their own prototypes. So within the same year, the Bank of Westminster, which is now a part of HSBC, that worked with Chubb, which we're familiar with making security products, things like locks, they came up with their own version. And then about 2 years later, the USA got their own first version. Then we see quite a lot of movement in this space very quickly. So by 1972, Lloyds have come up with the idea of their first online real-time ATM. And today in the UK, we have around 70, 75,000 working ATMs in the Link network, which is the largest network in the UK. And globally, you can see we've got 3.8 million ATMs. So we're still quite cash dependent when you look at the statistics. Recently, Link announced that there are going to be some cutbacks, but a lot of people are relying on ATMs to do lots of tasks, not just withdraw cash. And if you look at the global market as well, places like Asia, people carry out all manner of tasks on an ATM. So in Japan, for example, lots of people actually go to ATMs to carry out transactions that we would carry out at a cashier. Okay, so as part of this process, one thing that you need to know if you're going to buy an ATM is what the manufacturers are, obviously. So predominantly we see in North America, even South America and Europe, we've got Wincor and NCR. And then outside of that space, in Asia, we have Fujitsu and GRG Banking, and there's a few other outliers as well. But predominantly in this space, you're looking at Wincor and NCR. And as part of this process, I had to work out, okay, how am I going to go about buying an ATM? And as far as I could figure out, there was about four ways. I'll talk you through the options that I considered. Some were a bit dubious. So the first is the legal option that you can buy an ATM legally, either from a manufacturer or from maintainers. And I'll talk a bit more about what they are and what they do. And then you've got grey market, which is places like eBay, where you're not exactly sure of the origin of the goods, but it doesn't seem inherently criminal. So it seems okay. Then you've got the black market, which is things that you know have come from criminal intent. And then there was a fourth option that I considered in this process, which was suggested by our CEO. So our CEO has basically the craziest ideas, and I'll tell you about that as well, considered. So the first thing I did during this process is I looked at the grey market, and sure enough, the first thing I actually found is I found what seemed like a working ATM on eBay. So it looks good. There's a few issues with this. This particular item had a lock safe. No problem, I work in security. I know quite a few friends who can help me out with that. I wasn't entirely sure that this was working well, so I needed to go and have a look at it. But as it turns out, after doing some research, I found the company selling it. They lived about 30 minutes away from my house, so I arranged to go and see this particular item. The other issue with any ATM, it might seem obvious, but I'll point it out now, is a really big consideration is logistics. So a lot of the safety of an ATM is built into the vault, the weight, it's reinforced concrete. You're not meant to move this thing. So as an individual looking to store and move something that's close to a ton, it's very challenging, I'll tell you that. So this all looked great. And so I rang up the company, I was like, hey, can I come and see this item? And they said, we have a warehouse, we don't have anyone to take you now, it's a Friday, but come on Monday, we'll hold the item for you. I thought, okay, fantastic, great. I wait for these guys to call me back on Monday, and basically nothing really happened, and unfortunately I looked on eBay and the item had ended, and I was like, what the hell's going on? This seems pretty shady. I tried to get hold of them on the telephone, they didn't want to talk to me, so ensued a conversation where they basically told me the item had sold over the weekend, even though they're not open, and the website looked like it'd been built about 10 years ago. And I tried to counter offer, they told me it had been sold, and basically I didn't believe them. So I think what actually happened during this process is they decided that they weren't really sure that they should be selling this item and decided to take it down. So the other options that I considered during this process is our CEO had this really amazing idea. He said, you know what, for certainty, we can buy an ATM in Eastern Europe or Russia, like, no problem. Oh yeah, great idea, perfect. The only thing is, you guys need to drive it all the way back and across a load of borders, and they'll probably need like a 50,000 euro deposit, and you know, there's a chance of imprisonment, but hey, we'll definitely get an ATM in time for this event that we want to do. Yeah, great, that sounds awesome. So you can see that, like, we're talking about, okay, it's only going to take, if you drive non-stop, 6 to 7 days across Europe. Sounds great, right? No, not great. So as part of this process, I also phoned a few friends and I was like, you know, what are the possibilities of getting an ATM that's functioning, that has more questionable acquisition process? And it wasn't particularly fruitful, but if you were considering this, you might know some more dodgy friends than me. So definitely check it out. But as it turns out, what I realized is that actually legal procurement is relatively easy. We did it, or I did it predominantly up to a certain point until I needed money. And all you need to do is contact ATM maintainers. So there's two ATM maintainers in Europe, and that is SPC International and... Yeah, Testlink and SPC International. And all you need to do is ask them what they have in stock, essentially. But you do need to know a little bit about ATMs. So let's talk about that. Okay. So the first thing you need to do if you're going to buy an ATM is you've got to have a reason to buy an ATM, because they're going to ask you. If you're only buying one ATM, it sounds not like the most plausible story. So I found with maintainers they wanted to know what the backstory was, but for me that's relatively simple. I stuck pretty close to the truth, which is I work for a security company. We do ATM audits. We have ATMs in other places. We never bought them, but I didn't mention that bit. And everything eventually checked out when I sent them information about myself and my company and things like that. And they were like, oh, okay. You have to factor in things like lead time. So all of these companies, they get used ATMs from different places, banks, things like that. And they know what they're going to get in like 6 weeks plus time. So if you've got a tight deadline, it's something to factor in. Is they can tell you, oh, we'll have this specific model in at a certain point, but you've just got to keep that in mind. You can get two different types of ATMs. You can get something that's called tested, which just means that they've tested the functionality, but there's a chance that some functions and features of the ATM might not actually work when you get it. And then there's something called completely refurbished, which is as it sounds, they check everything thoroughly and make sure it's definitely working. So we bought an ATM that was tested, which is a bit more challenging. And the other thing you need to realise is like what kind of specific model you want. I would definitely suggest, you can find all this information out using Google essentially, but go for something that's freestanding. If you're an individual, it's probably the easiest thing to go for. And as I mentioned previously, logistics is a really big challenge. So you need to figure out where can you store this thing and what can hold an ATM, because most floors can't actually hold ATMs, and you've got to power the thing, protect it from the elements, and if you're a security company, you might want to move it again as well. And so finding anyone to move an ATM is just an absolute nightmare. So as it turns out, as I mentioned, we bought an ATM from Testlink for the grand total of £3,000, including VAT. So it's not an astronomical amount, you might be surprised by that. And delivery. So let's talk about logistics a bit more. As I mentioned, it's an absolute nightmare. So I had quite specific ideas of what this was going to be like on delivery day. And it turned out to be a bit more like this. So what happened is a dude turned up with a truck. It wasn't like a large truck, and it had a tail lift. And he was very confident with maneuvering the ATM, but it was clearly overloaded for the vehicle. And he said, look, we're not going to get it into any ground floor of an office. It will just crush the floor. So I didn't have too many options. We ended up putting this thing in a car park, which has its challenges, but some really interesting things happen. As soon as you have an ATM that you deposit somewhere, I found that people were immediately asking us when could they use the ATM. Okay, this is really interesting if you work in security. We also moved this ATM at one point to my house, because it turned out to be the best place to store it. And again, my neighbours were like, when can we use the ATM? Interesting research project, right? Easy way to collect card numbers and PIN codes and all the rest. Very easy. So as I mentioned, it's also a challenge to protect it from things like the elements and to provide electricity. So at this point, we have an ATM in the car park. And just to give you a bit of a reality of what that looks like,
we'll see if audio works on the video.
Just keep dropping it.
This is us lowering the extension
where you are is great.
The three-story board a building to get power into the car park on the weekend before InfoSec. A lot of fun. So. Yes. Okay, that which brings me on to the next section, which is how does it work and how can you break it? Which is probably a bit more exciting. So let's talk about some of the components of the ATM. So you have a PC at the top, and basically, okay, so you've got the PC at the top, dispenser here which holds cassettes and that holds all the notes. And that slots into the vault, which is all that reinforced concrete here. Then you have some other hardware components like the pin pad and the card reader at the front that you're familiar with as well. And then everything connects to the banking network. So what does that normally look like? There's a few possibilities. So you could have something that's in branch, which connects directly to the ATM network. You can have something which is remote, like in an airport or out of a branch in a shop, and that might connect via like a 3G or 4G modem. And we'll talk a little bit about the attack vectors overall first, and then we're going to get into talking about application control. So there's four main attack vectors, but when it comes to hacking an ATM, what you work out is that it normally involves a combination of factors. It's not a single attack vector. So you've got brute force, which happens to still be one of the most popular and effective ways of getting money out of an ATM. I know we all work in security, but sometimes the really simple things are the most effective things. Then we have things at the OS level. So you're looking at things like kiosk bypass, anything around like misconfiguration. Hardware, so you can do things like change the media, get it to boot up from different media. You can do a black box attack, so connect directly to the dispenser and send commands directly to that. But this involves getting access to the service area. So again, we're looking at multiple different ways of attacking it. And then you've got network attacks. So sometimes with the ATMs that are situated in remote locations, you can just directly plug into the network yourself. So we'll look at some of those examples with a history of attacks first. So in 2010, Barnaby Jack quite famously demonstrated at Black Hat how to cash out from an ATM. And what he did is he connected to some remote admin tools on ATMs, which made the cash machines like dramatically spit out cash. If you haven't seen that clip, you can find it online. And then in 2012, we see an emergence of black box attacks. And 2013, we start seeing a lot of logical attacks emerging. And then a year later, a number of companies, including our own, started publishing research in this specific space and recommendations on how to secure ATMs. So brute force attacks, still really, really popular. There was a rise in the last year, up 30%. Now, a lot of people think that this kind of thing happens in places like Eastern Europe or Latin America. This is an ATM in Liverpool in 2016, so you might be surprised that this happens a lot even in the UK.
To be fair, Liverpool's a bit like the Middle East anyway.
Maybe, but I'm sure these sort of things happen in London as well. So here's another example, and I'll tell you a little bit about how this actually works. So what happens is you take a crowbar or another device that allows you to open the cash dispenser a little bit, and then you force compressed air into the compartment and you ignite it, and it cleanly blows up the vault, leaving you with money. Of course, you can have security mechanisms in the cassettes itself, so if you're a highly motivated criminal, you should probably factor this in as well. Hopefully we're not dealing with any highly motivated criminals here. And here's another example of a brute force attack, just to demonstrate how quickly you can get away with money out of an ATM. So where some guys, like, they managed to use a vehicle to pull the ATM out of the bank, but they hadn't factored in lifting the ATM onto the vehicle. So for me, this was kind of hilarious. I was like, oh yeah, you didn't factor in the weight of the ATM, really. So they couldn't get away with cash. So operating system level attacks. So commonly on an ATM, you have a few security mechanisms. One of them is kiosk mode, which you'll see on many kind of point of sales terminals, and all it does is it limits the number of functions that a user can access. So you might even see them at, like, you go to a zoo and you can see those iPads and they show you about animals, the same thing. Normally you can escape these just by either toggling out, like there's various gestures if you're looking at iPads and things like that. On an ATM you can bypass these by issuing a number of hotkeys. And to do that, therefore, you need to, so this is where the combination of factors comes in. It's still relatively simple, so here's my cat demonstrating how to do that in some way. You need to access, you need to issue key functions so you can access some of the peripherals by just drilling into the front of the facade, which is plastic. So you can do this with a household drill. I've done it with a household drill. And confirm that, and then you can use keyboard, you can just toggle with Alt Tab to get access to some of the other parts of the system. So when you bypass kiosk mode, you might also encounter things like a keyboard disabler, but you can just escape that application and quit it. And then you can use Internet Explorer to access the operating system, which is really great. So at that point, if you've got access to the inside of the computer, like you've drilled the hole, you can probably figure out how to plug in a device as well, so then you can issue commands to the dispenser, and bingo, you've got cash. So here's a really short video outside of my house.
Screen or a screen you see in an ATM. All I need to do is...
Sorry for the slightly monotone voice.
On the keyboard is actually just key combinations in access.
And we quite commonly hear about malware attacks on ATMs as well, and with ATMs, most of them are running some form of Windows XP, and some of the new ones are running Windows 7, so they're Microsoft systems. And what the malware does is it interacts with XFS library, which you can, like, Google about, and it's documented, so it's easy to develop malware specifically for ATMs. And moving on to hardware, as I mentioned, if you want to gain access to the hardware, there's a couple of ways. So one is you could drill into the actual facade, and a lot of people, again, might think this is unrealistic, but many attacks happen like this. An attacker will drill part of the facade, they'll cover it up and they'll come back. Or, in some cases, they actually replace the whole plastic facade. Sometimes you don't even need to drill into the facade, but it's so feebly made that you can break pieces of it off. The other thing you can do in order to access hardware is you can gain access to the service area at the rear, which typically has a lock, but you can bribe a service engineer, for example, and then you can do things like communicate directly with the dispenser itself. And as I mentioned, network attacks, sometimes you can plug directly into the network. So here's some pictures of some ATMs in various locations. And you can see all the equipment is directly accessible by anyone. Here's one that I saw in an airport. At least they put like a box around it and they have cameras around it. So this is a much better way of doing things. Which brings us on to the next section.
Thanks, Liam. None of this story would happen without this woman. As you realized, it is very
curious stories about ATMs, and during the last couple of years I've realized that, yeah, how to buy an ATM, how to break into ATM, what vendors are and how they respond on the security issues. Everything is quite bizarre and peculiar. So as you see, ATM attacks rises from year to year. It's still relatively, most of attacks are about physical access, but logical attacks raises. And today I'm going to speak only about very small field, because we are here on application security conference. I'm going to speak about application control. If you don't know, application control is quite brand new tools which appeared a couple of years ago from main antivirus vendors like Kaspersky, McAfee, Checkpoint, and they created specifically for purposes when normal antiviruses with behavior signature analysis doesn't work very well. And literally monthly appears new security bulletins about vulnerabilities in all products, and new attack vectors. You can Google it with application control bypasses and you will be very curious by how many are them. Why so? First of all, because in the last couple of years, security researchers aimed on security products when they realized that they are not so secure as they expected initially. And second, application control is, as I said, quite new type of product, and it might work not so good as we expected. So how it should work, first of all, and what is it for? First of all, it is type of software which works on isolated systems or systems with a lot of user interaction when it comes a lot of incoming messages with applications and attachments, and normal signature analysis does not work very well. How it works? So basically it creates the list of predefined files and executable applications and simply prohibit everything except this based on whitelisting of directories, files, comparing hashes, ability of digital signatures, and sometimes you can even meet application control with when it simply checks extension blacklist, so mainly you just rename file.exe to .any you want and it will bypass restrictions. So, as I said, there are a lot of bypassing techniques starting from execution in trusted applications when you can find buffer overflows, or in case that applications are created specifically for launching arbitrary code like .NET, Java, PowerShell, which you can always meet in ATMs as well, and sometimes we can meet in PHP there, don't ask me why. Next, of course, you can try to bypass extension blacklist. Speaking of hash comparison, you always can think first about hash collisions attacks. And main problem is about misconfigurations when bank engineers simply do not know how they should properly configure this type of software, because there are like dozens of different configuration options, like protecting from DLL injections. You always can find poor restrictions. For example, basically, literally like a week ago appeared new research about bypassing application control with PowerShell scripts, which are available by default in Windows operating systems. But now, speaking of application security, I will specify only on actual exploits on these types of products. So, since last year, we had audits of more than 20 different ATMs, and it were like more than 7 or 8 different application control tools, and all of them we bypassed in the end successfully, and I'm going to tell some of the stories. So, product number one. Product number one is very interesting. First of all, its password contains in a plain text in database, and all you can need is just to have admin rights. Sometimes you don't even need to have admin rights to read this file and get these passwords in plain text. To be honest, problem when admin rights is pretty enough to disable security restrictions is very common in application control field. Second is also very popular stuff. Basically, application control protects 32 bits application. It simply forget about 16 bits, which means that you almost always can run 16-bit applications, which means you can read and write from files and to files. You can read and write to registry. It is really hard to communicate with DLL like MSXFS, but it's still possible. Third problem of specifically this application is if it runs MSI file, which is Windows installator, it checks two things. First, it checks that MSI exec has exactly the same hash sum. And second, it checks digital signature of MSI file. But if we will move MSI exec to another folder and run exactly the same parameters, the only one check will be only checking of MSI exec hash sum, which will be succeeded, obviously. Fourth, and one of my favorite, is updates issues over HTTP without any kind of application signature, which means if you can substitute server and plug in device to your own network, you're basically just giving your own executable and force an application to update itself and successfully running cache out, for example. After a security advisory to vendor, it fixes it at some point by adding digital signature. But it turned out that it's not so secure, and now we are working about bypassing this technique. So, second product, one of the weakest one, obviously. First and also very popular problem is that a lot of products does not work simply in safe mode, which means if you can run ATM in safe mode, security drivers will not start and you simply can just delete them, reboot once again, and that's all. Second, if you will put your own application in auto run and it will be started before this application, which also works as application not as a service, you can just simply catch up the handler and this handler will be busy and the application simply will not start. Third, as and always one of my favorite, is remote control over unencrypted traffic. Let's call it HTTP, which means just record and replicate the request to disable security mechanisms or sending arbitrary comments will bring us to arbitrary code execution on the system because obviously there are no signatures, no any kind of protection. And once again, we informed vendor, it came this kind of solution, which were a digital signature with RSA, this MD5 cipher, which obviously is not so good because RSA now is trying to prohibit this type of signatures. But we found a much easier solution because it turned out that signature check on checks only for remote code execution command or for turning on the protection, exactly the one which we sent to vendor. But it does not check MD5 for deleting arbitrary files, and it turned out it doesn't have self-control mechanisms, which means you can just send command to delete protected driver and okay, that's all. Third product, really very secure, I'm not kidding, one of my favorite one, has signatures, drivers are protected, everything is great. But how works checking algorithms? As you remember, isolated systems like ICS, SCADA, ATMs might be quite old, which means Pentium 2 and vendor just developed protection mechanisms. So initially It has to calculate hash sum of the file before checking in comparison, and it contains timeout for calculation. But it turned out that after timeout, it would be run, not prohibited, which means you are filling your exploit with a lot of zeros and wait until it will bypass 30 seconds by default timeout, and then it will be run. Sadly, it will be run. It will be run only once. But there are special executable files like Python exe, PHP exe, and so on, which are specifically created to run files with different checks, so yeah, like scripts. And in these cases, these files and scripts would be run without checking of hash sum, would be checking all the time, not only once. 6th, 4th, and 5th products had binary vulnerabilities. I'm really very poor in binary vulnerabilities, to be honest. I'm more about application security. It contains network-based buffer overflow, which brought us to multi-cloud execution. The second one contained unauthorized privilege escalations, for which could be exploited via drivers. And but the main problem of local vulnerabilities, as we realized, that to launch your exploit exe, you need to bypass restrictions for running this exploit exe. It's quite sometimes hard, but sometimes you can find a lot of solutions to make this work. So in the end, as I said, there were 7 products during last year. All of them were bypassed, and it turned out 8 products, which was Microsoft one. And one of them offered us 10 bottles of brandy if we would bypass this product. So we are trying to work on it right now. I'm not speaking about finding 0 days in Microsoft products. I'm more about I bet it would be a lot of poor restrictions and misconfigurations. One more story about application security is about industrial 3G modems. As Liam already said, there are a lot of cases when ATMs connected via 3G modems. And of course, it is not small USB dongles as you used to use in your laptops. It's huge, big plastic devices which cost 10 times more. But it turned out they contain exactly the same vulnerabilities as might contain small home vendors. Like, vendors sometimes and banks simply forget that hackers might just downgrade 3G, 4G signal, connect 3G modem to his own 2G network, and get access via fake base station to, for example, web interface outside the VPN channel. Then you can bypass somehow authentication authorization, and basically that's all. You can infect modem first of all and be completely hidden from the security guys, and second, you get an access to plain text traffic, which means you can extract money as well. One more thing which we found out basically several months ago, but exploit were created exactly last week, is we found out that most of these modems contains their own proprietary VPN. So yeah, why do you need to use OpenVPN or Microsoft one? Let's create our own VPN. So what possibly could go wrong? And here's what. Infecting one ATM, bringing us to infect the whole network. Yeah, of course. But it turned out that this specific 3G modem has to build VPN, has end-to-end tunnel, and binary on the both side, on the ATM 3G modem and on the host side was exactly the same binaries. And basically they contain remote code execution. So you can get access not to only one ATM, you can get access to whole network. But a couple of days ago, we realized that we broke not into bank's network, we broke into the maintainer network. And we found out not only one bank ATM network, but 6 banks ATM networks. Yeah, big surprise for us. Nobody's jailed now, but I don't know. Yeah, so, as you can imagine, most of these vulnerabilities would not be covered without our reverse engineers from Basic Research Center and a lot of enthusiasts who is really want into security of ATMs. And keep in touch. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much for a fascinating talk. Right, I think now it's time for Q&A. Before I move on to the questions on the slide, I do, I'm going to take a few questions from the audience. Any questions from the audience?
I actually put mine on slide up too as well, so you can build that one on there. When a cash machine is hacked, how does the... In addition, I assume the ATM vendor is liable if it's shown that the hack is trivial to execute. Are there regulatory fines or contractual fines that some of the banks can use on the ATM vendors to kind of motivate them to really to like tighten this up a bit?
That's a great question. In fact, what might be awesome is if there's anyone who works for a bank in this room, maybe they'll be able to answer that question. Dan? Maybe you can talk openly. I mean, you can talk about the fact that maybe there aren't so many liabilities.
I think ATM security is still stuck in the 70s. So this is chat and house rules here. ATM security is still stuck in the 90s, the 70s. So we're only now starting to see that the attacks are taking place. You've got the normal Scouse one that we saw just attacking with the brute force. But Eastern Europe, there's more and more digital ones. Proving ground at the moment is Brazil. Brazil will always be the sexiest place in the world to do this kind of attack. But I think the regulator and the fines and everything else are just not catching up, because it's not a physical attack, it's a digital attack. So who's liable? Is it the software vendor? Because most banks don't own their ATMs.
Yes, exactly. That's what
so
I was thinking.
So they pass the buck saying, well, we thought it was a secure thing, so yeah. So it's a bit of a mess at the moment.
So to add to that, so if a bank doesn't own an ATM and basically the manufacturers turn around and they just say, well, you just need to buy a new ATM, or we just supplied you with the ATM. So it's really about how they configure everything. But it is passing the buck. Like with many things in security, right? If you look at, for example, consumer products now, we see a lot with IoT. Security isn't built into the manufacturing process at all, but who's liable for that? They'll just say, well, the customer needs to update the firmware.
More questions?
Yeah. Hiya. You know how you get like evil chip-a-pin devices and things like that? There's been quite a few of them circulating around the world. Where they've actually had the malware placed before it's actually been brought out, so it's been done by certain people at the manufacturers. Do you find that there's more checks being done now, or do you think there's actually more checks being done now at the manufacturer level of what's being done by their own staff?
I don't know that we can actually comment on that. All the interactions that we've had with some of the manufacturers, they tend to be quite defensive. But we don't have any experience of what goes on there, so we're not in a great position to comment on that, unfortunately. Anyone who works for WinCore or NCR, either online or here, wants to answer that question, they're welcome to.
Okay, more questions? No? Okay, I'll read the ones from the slide. Okay, there was a question about, do you think there's a third-party contractors for ATM maintenance is the most secure option for UK banks on a long-term basis?
From my perspective, bank is also always trying to get out of subcontractors, yeah, speaking of maintenance of ATM, because it's much more risks there, but at the same time, you basically has no other option, right?
Yes, that's true, and we have heard of some horror stories like maintainers using the same password for local admin on an ATM, which is like the manufacturer of the ATM, for example. So it's questionable, because obviously you put your faith in a third party, but I think what we realise in security is if you have agreements with third party, it doesn't matter what they do for you, you should actually audit them and check that they have those controls in place, because they say one thing, but is that actually the case? You know, they're agreeing to that legally. So you can go and audit these people, not just for ATMs, but any other security providers as well.
Yeah, just remember the story from last year, ATM maintainer spread viruses from their own USB sticks.
Yeah.
It took an ages to find out who was the problem.
Interesting. Right. There's a bit of a technical question that I think that's for you. How long was that timeout for Hashcock?
30 seconds.
30 seconds.
Yeah. 30 seconds.
It's your cat.
Right, so not that long.
It's not my cat.
Not that long.
Okay. Any more questions? Oh, there's one question. Can you hear me? So from the attacks that you showed us, which one would you choose actually to attack an ATM? The physical attack, the network attack, drilling in, you know, with the attacks on a keyboard?
When we make security assessment for bank's ATMs, we are starting from the simpler one, of course. Yeah, from operating system levels, and then we are trying to cover everything else, like network. And in the last couple of months, we started to do a lot of work in the field of black box attacks, I mean, against already existing black box protection. So it really depends on what ATM we are talking about. Yeah, if it is old one, almost always you can use black box. If it is brand new one with Windows 10, with all restricted keyboards and mouse and everything else, sometimes you need to think how to catch up.
Sometimes you need to
put it. Yeah.
Okay, one more question.
Do you find that ATMs are sufficient logging and auditing? So if you hacked into one and you've told it to cash out, is that properly logged?
Well, yeah, of course it depends on banks. A lot of banks use, for example, CM, and obviously you can track in the end that ATM was compromised, yeah.
But how many, I mean, we all know from experience, I know from experience of being in other people's data centers, that the reality is, like, often if you have an incident, you go and try and find the logging, it's normally non-existent. Like, even when organizations think they have logging, or even when they think they have a segmented network, you go in there and often what you think you know about your network is completely different. So it's just a computer on top of the vault, so probably not in most cases.
Right, if there are no more questions, let's thank Leanne and Tim for a fantastic we are going to break for a few minutes to grab some more pizza and drinks and.